Now on BBC HD, seeing out the evening with the story of a 16th century adventurer, Leo Africanus, a man between two worlds.
The royal court is magnificent. The king has a rich treasure of coins and gold ingots. A single one of these ingots weighs 970 pounds. Grain and animals are abundant and the inhabitants are very rich. Instead of coined money, pure gold nuggets are used.
This was how the Western world first heard of the legendary city of Timbuktu.
Five hundred years ago, a young man stood here, whose travels and writings would not only make him one of the greatest travelers of all time, but would also open up the heart of Africa to the rest of the world.
Born a Muslim called al-Hasan ibn Muhammad al-Wazzan, that young man became known as Leo Africanus, a Christian convert. During his life, he would be a refugee, a spy, and even a captive slave. From these experiences, he wrote his great book, The Description of Africa.
It was his intellectual journeys between Europe and Africa and spiritual journeys between Islam and Christianity, when rival kingdoms were fighting for power, that have made him enduringly important.
This is my journey to try and reveal the man behind the myth, Leo Africanus. It was in Rome that the most Arabic of scholars found an international audience. Although born a Muslim, he was known by a Latin name, Leo Africanus, Leo the African. And what might be the only picture of him shows him dressed as a European intellectual. And the only surviving copy of the manuscript that made his name was written not in Arabic, but Italian. When it was published, it caused a sensation.
This is 500 years old. This is history in your hands. Book that changed the way Europeans and Westerners in general looked at Africa.
It is written in Italian. And there is a date at the end of the book on the 10th of March, 1526, in Rome. Mm-hmm.
This is the closest thing we can get to Leo Africanus. It's not his own handwriting, but he dictated every word in the book.
The scribe was Lebanese, and his handwriting is known from other books. We know this is from a professional.
Yeah, it's professional scribe. That's why you can see the beautiful writing.
Yes.
When he was writing this book, he had in mind mainly the Italian and European readers rather than Muslim or African readers.
Yes, absolutely.
He was writing it for the Europeans. Was it a popular book? Was it something that scholars at the time and geographers and travelers would like to read and to discover about Africa?
This work was very important because the Occidental world didn't know anything about Northern Africa if not from the classics. From the classic authors of the Roman Empire. After the Roman Empire, there were no news about Africa, about geography, about people, because the Christianity couldn't get access to the Arabic Muslim world. At the end of the work, and he says, finished the book of the composer Messer Joan Leone Granatino, which means from Granada, on Africa and its cities, rivers and mountains in Africa.
So, my first clue to the man behind the book is that he was from Granada in Islamic Spain, Al-Andalus. To begin to understand Leo, you have to understand the world he was born into. It was dominated by conflict between the superpowers of the day. To the east, the Ottoman Empire. To the west, the powers of France and Spain, and the Holy Roman Empire. Just a few years after Leo's birth, in the late 1480s, Al-Andalus would suffer a defeat that overturned 800 years of Moorish culture in Spain. and see the expulsion of tens of thousands of families. This was Leo's world.
Spain was part of al-Maghrib at the time for geographers, the west part of the Islamic world. So it's
Andalusia at that time was considered by geographers as part of al-Maghrib.
Al-Maghrib, it was a same geographical area. Mm. Granada was a metropole, I would say, the New York of that time. Maybe 100,000 inhabitants. That culture has left so many traces, reminiscences, till now, in what we're seeing all around us. You see here churches, before there were mosques, always in this beautiful neighborhood, still preserve the shape of the Islamic city with very narrow streets, wood houses, what was usually traditional with lime, not now. But you still have all this greenery inside the houses because we still preserve this beautiful habit of the Islamic tradition and civilization is to put the garden inside the house. So the garden is the paradise, and the paradise at home.
The layout of the narrow streets and closely packed houses of Muslim Granada still survives in the Al-Baythin, the city's Arabic quarter. But it's only in Morocco, in North Africa, just 15 miles away from the coast of Spain, that you can see a house of the period and visit the earthly paradise that well-to-do Arabs created for themselves.
Assalamu alaikum. Smah. Assalamu alaikum.
Bismillah.
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 Barakallahu feekum. Shukran. Alhamdulillah.
Leo's name at birth was al-Hasan ibn Muhammad al-Wazzan, and it gives us the biggest clue to the life he was born into. It means Hassan, the son of Muhammad, the way master.
Al-naqsh al-khashabi hada wa sharh. He's telling me that this yellow color we can see here is made out of egg yolks, and still after 400 years, the yellow color is still bright.
Most of the houses are built of fine bricks and strikingly painted stone. The ceilings of the houses are adorned with gold, azure, and other excellent colors. The doors are supported with finely plastered brick pillars. Some are made of marble.
As a waymaster in Granada, Leo's father would have been a high-ranking town official. It would have been a prosperous job and given his family a luxurious life.
This is the city that must have shaped Leo's childhood. Tolerant, cultured, and outward-looking, with connections to Africa, Arabia, and the rest of Europe. Throughout his life, Leo thought of this city as being his true home city and calling himself Leo the Granadan, al-Gharnati.
But all of this was about to come to an abrupt end, and nearly 800 years of peace and tolerance of Jews, Christians, and Muslims living together would be swept away. By the early 1490s, just a few years after Leo's birth, the forces of Catholic Spain began to gather against Granada. They were to ethnically cleanse the city with the frenzy of the Inquisition, an event that's still remembered with sorrow in the Arab world until today.
Thousands of North African families trace their roots back to here, to Granada and Al-Andalus in general. My own family, who lives in Fes in Morocco, trace our ancestry back to this city, making it a living link between the two cultures and religions.
I feel like I am in my homeland. When I walk in the streets, I feel like I am in my own country, as if it's an Islamic land.
In 1492, the citadel of Alhambra was conquered, and Granada was snatched away from its Moorish rulers. Muhammad XII, the last sultan of the Kingdom of Granada, surrendered to the Catholic monarchs, Isabella and Ferdinand. The Reconquista, as it was known, brought the Moorish civilization in Spain and Al-Andalus as a political entity to an end.
It's the end, really, of a whole period, the end of the Muslim Spain after almost 8 centuries of presence of a culture here. Because the Catholic kings arrive with the Inquisition, so they expelled the Jews in 1492. In 1500, they obliged the Muslims to convert themselves into the Catholic religion.
Sometimes so, forcibly.
Oh, completely. Yeah. If not, they would be expelled. The family of Leo Africanus, al-Hasan al-Wazzan, mm-hmm. they moved, like many aristocratic families.
Yeah. Under the terms of the city's surrender, Muslims were given a 3-year period to either convert or to leave the city unmolested, taking their wealth and belongings with them. Leo's family chose to flee rather than to convert. Many Muslims made the same choice. They headed for Africa, and the new chapter in Leo's life was about to begin. When he made this crossing with his parents, it must have seemed that the narrow Strait of Gibraltar marked the boundary between persecution and safety. But in reality, the world he was about to enter was no less volatile.
He was heading for Fes, then the capital city of northern Morocco, where he had really powerful connections. His uncle worked for the Sultan.
The kingdom of Fes was under threat from 3 different enemies: the Spaniards and the Portuguese from the north, the Ottomans from the east, and from the south, from a rising power that would one day rule all of Morocco and most of West Africa.
These were the forces that would define his future and propel him into a life of travel, adventure, and even espionage.
Fes in the 1490s must have been a busy and crowded city. And newcomers would have had to struggle to find a foothold.
Leo's family was just one of thousands of refugees arriving from Spain. They were looking for a new house, a new job, and a new life. Many Fesi families, including mine, trace their roots back to Al-Andalus.
But Leo and his family could have found a refuge in the house of his father's brother, who was well established in Fes.
Assalamu alaikum, si Anas. Assalamu alaikum, Hajj. And this is my brother Kamal. Assalamu alaikum.
And although it was a strange city in a strange country, it may have felt almost like returning home. He had family waiting to welcome him. He would have heard Arabic, the language of his Andalusian childhood spoken everywhere.
A good Fasi couscous.
And even the customs and the food were familiar.
It looks good. One of the things Leo was talking about in his book is a good Fasi couscous.
In winter, they have cooked meat together with a kind of food called couscous.
She's saying that it's best to do a couscous with your own hands rather than with any cutlery, because it tastes better with hands.
Which is made of damp flour in the shape of small pepper grains, cooked in a peculiar vessel full of holes called a xcas.
Okay. Can I take the couscous now?
After it is steamed, they add butter to it and then sauce.
Okay. Ooh,
they eat lovely. This all together from the same dish.
Let's go and eat.
Despite the similarities, Morocco was a new country. And like exiles everywhere, the Andalusians kept a separate identity, keeping their distinctive names and customs alive to this day. Throughout his life, Leo would spend years living in new cultures, absorbing their ways, but keeping his own identity strong and clear. When we were young, you used to tell us that our ancestors came from Andalusia. Were they kicked out after the fall of Granada?
True. According to what our ancestors told us, we do indeed come from Andalusia. After they were expelled from Andalusia, they came to settle down in Fez, in a place called Bin'adis. We have kept our Andalusian traditions and we still consider ourselves as such.
Al-Sa'igh, our surname, means goldsmith. Is this because our ancestors worked as goldsmiths or traders of gold?
Yes, that's true. But they were not only makers of gold, but makers of knowledge.
Many of the Andalusian refugees came from educated families, and it was no accident that they chose to settle in Fes. It's home to one of the greatest universities of the world, Al-Qarawiyyin.
Assalamu alaikum.
Professor Mustafa Ben Sdira has spent his career studying the life of Leo and knows the city that he lived in better than anyone.
I think that Leo probably walked on the ground that we are walking on now, because in his book, The Description of Africa, he talks about Al-Bu'naniyya, which is up the road from here.
Do you mean the famous Al-Bu'naniyya school?
Indeed, the famous school that was built by Sultan Abu Inan, where Leo said that he studied.
There are almost 200 schools in Fez for the instruction of children. The schoolmasters teach their children to write and read, not out of a book, but from a great chart. Every day, they chant one sentence of the Quran, and having read all the way through, they begin it again, repeating it often, until they have most firmly committed it to memory.
When he'd learned the Quran by heart, an achievement most boys managed by the age of 14, Leo enrolled at Al-Qarawiyyin University.
According to Guinness Book of Records, this is the oldest university for higher education in the world. It is not only a mosque, but a place of teaching. The way it was built is so detailed and fine. Leo described it in big detail. He talked about the archways and the water fountains inside it. When you go inside and read his book, you find everything in detail in front of you.
Around the walls of the mosque are pulpits, out of which scholars who are learned in Islamic law instruct the people.
Plenty of tourists come from all over the world to come and see Fes and Old Medina and Al-Qarawiyyin University, which is world famous. But I'm quite sure that a tiny minority of these people have read Leo's description of Fes. And it's amazing because what Westerners know about Fes, they must have learned it from Leo.
Despite his high learning, Leo was able to bring a common touch to capturing the daily life of the ordinary man. Even today, walking through the Medina, the details that caught Leo's eyes are still all around you.
Throughout his life, he called it the city where I was born. His detailed description of its neighborhoods, markets, streets, and even people shows how much he loved this city. It's amazing how Leo's description of Fes is as accurate today as it was 500 years ago. While he was describing the women of Fes, which he found very beautiful, he was describing their nice dress. But he was always shocked to see their golden belts. He found them very, very ugly. Those belts are actually still existing today and they're still being sold in all the Medina of Fes. Personally, I don't think they are ugly. I think they are very beautiful.
The women are not altogether unseemly dressed. When they go out, they put on long breeches that cover their legs. And also, in the fashion of Syria, they have a veil hanging down from their heads, which covers their whole bodies. Their ears they adorn with golden earrings and precious jewels.
The description of Africa was originally published in Italian in 1550, then in French and Latin, and eventually in English in 1600. It made Leo a part of the European canon, and his book has been published 30 times, but not in Arabic, not until 1982.
وأنا أبحث في الوزان وجدت إشارة غريبة.
When I was doing my research about Leo, I found a very curious hint. We all assume that his parents were both Muslims, but there is one reference in the Arabic encyclopedia in the 8th volume which says that Leo's father was Muslim and his mother was a Jew who converted to Islam before marriage. We don't know whether this is true and whether this had an influence on his life or to what extent did it affect his behavior and his ability to adapt everywhere. Because he had a great ability to blend in or assimilate into any society. This is only an assumption and we don't know how true it is.
Every country bears the marks and traditions of other cultures who bring new ideas, languages or habits, even new foods. As a refugee from Spain, with a childhood in Morocco and now possibly the child of a converted Jewish woman, Leo was in a unique position to understand that identity is very different from mere nationality or religion.
It wasn't only the Andalusian Muslims who had to flee to Fes. The Jewish population of Granada was treated badly as well, and they had to flee the country. They came and settled down here in this place called Al-Mallah.
They occupy a long street in the city, where they have their shops and synagogues. And the number is marvelously increased ever since they were driven out of Spain.
There used to be tens of thousands of Jews in Fes who could trace their roots back to the fall of Granada. But after the Second World War, many left Morocco. Today, there are only a few of them left in Fes. Hidden away in the back streets of the Medina is another significant place in his life, one that might have offered him not only his first paid work as a writer, but might also have given him his first meetings with foreigners.
This is a very important place in the life of Leo. He spent 2 years here working as a scribe.
500 years ago, this building was a bimaristan, a hospital or a refuge for the insane, but also an infirmary for sick foreign travelers.
Assalamu alaikum.
Occasionally, a foreigner will come near one of the rooms. The madman will call to him and complain that they are being held here for no reason, and that they are subjected to thousands of abuses by the guards.
Now there is barely a memory of Leo here. Certainly, the stallholders are more familiar with the tales of the madman than the hospital's most famous employee. Although for Western tourists, his name is commemorated on a plaque in the courtyard, where the overspill from the tiny mosque that remains still pray five times a day. Perhaps here too, he witnessed the Muslim tradition of care for the vulnerable and protection and hospitality for travelers. At this time, Leo was also starting to look beyond the pious confines of university and hospital.
In this city are almost 200 inns. None come here but the most lewd and wicked people, so that they may more boldly commit villainy. Only the straight law of history forces me to report this. I would much rather have smothered such matters in silence, as they tend so extremely to the disgrace of Fez.
When it all got too much for him, he made his escape to the countryside. What's the occasion?
We are on the way to a little shrine just outside the walls of the city of Fes. We have been told that this little place used to be the spiritual retreat for Leo Africanus. He used to come here every now and then, just to have peace of mind and contemplate.
L'Arbad is a palace built on the top of a high hill. I stayed in this palace four times in the summer season because of the fresh air. A secluded place like this is good for whoever wants to study. My father rented this land from the mosque for many years.
Showing me to this little-known place is Professor Mustafa Taher. It offers another key to a hidden facet of Leo's character.
Wow. This is Fez in its full glory. No wonder he loved it. I've lived in this place for 22 years. I've never seen it from this place, and I've never seen it as beautiful as now.
He said, from this vantage point, the Al-Ubad castle, you can see all the lands and the villages around Fez, and even the minarets of the mosques. He was able to do so many things from this place. The castle was his residence, and he always remembers and reveres the people who lived here before him, including the saint called Sidi Ahmad Bernoussi, who is buried here. And even though Al-Wazzan didn't believe in miracles and saints, this is exactly where we find his dual personality.
Like many great writers, Shakespeare for example, Leo has the habit of immersing himself in the detail of other people's lives, while keeping himself hidden. It's almost as if he had been trained by birth and early experiences to keep his distance and look clearly on the situations he found himself in.
This man lived in two environments, the Andalusian and the Fassi Morocco. He sums this up in a story of the amphibious bird and comparing himself to it. God gave this bird the ability to live both in the skies and in the seas. When he's asked to pay taxes in the skies, he goes and lives with the fish in the sea. And when he feels injustice in the sea, he leaves and goes back to the skies with the birds. He says at the end, a human being by nature seeks whatever serves his interests as much as he can.
The author concludes from this that whenever a man sees his advantage, he always follows it.
It's clear that Leo had a privileged upbringing and an exclusive education. And when his student days drew to an end, he was presented to the court of the Sultan of Fes by his well-connected uncle.
Leo's uncle was a trusted envoy of the Sultan of Fes. He was sent on diplomatic missions to different parts in Morocco and beyond. He would often take the young Leo with him on his missions.
This is when Leo gets his first taste of adventure, and it's now that he starts to systematically note and describe what he sees. Despite its title, The Description of Africa, more than half of Leo's book is about Morocco, based on his notes and memories of this time. He is starting to build up a geographic and topographic index of North Africa, something that would later be extremely interesting to his adventurous European readers.
I was taught in the West and describe each of the mountains and each of the towns according to my method. Nearly all the rivers of Africa stem from the Atlas. Its waterfalls are very cold, even in the heat of summer. And the most fertile plains are those between the Atlas and the ocean.
In one of his travels to the Atlas Mountains,
Leo stopped in one of the villages around this place. It's called Imuzar. He said of these people that they were living on olive harvesting, and it seems they are still doing the same thing until today.
Olive trees surround an area of 5 miles around the city. The inhabitants are wealthy, but they wear clothes stained with oil because they make oil throughout the year and take it to Fes to sell it.
It's the best olive oil you can ever taste.
By this time, the early 16th century, European explorers and traders had a good knowledge of the coastal regions of Africa and were even beginning to travel up the great rivers. But the heart of the continent, darkest Africa, was the great unknown.
It was Leo's travels outside Morocco that changed the way Europe looked at Africa. And his travels helped inspire a generation of travelers who were to follow in his footsteps.
In the early 1500s, Leo began a series of journeys outside of Morocco, ranging as far afield as Egypt, Turkey, and even the Arabian Peninsula and Mecca. But it was one destination above all that caught the imagination of European emperors and travelers, Timbuktu, a name that's synonymous with mystery and danger. The fact we've heard of it at all is entirely due to Leo Africanus.
Merchants on their way to Timbuktu have to cross the desert. They cross at its widest diameter, causing the death of many men and animals.
Those who survived would find themselves on one of the great rivers in Africa, where traders in canoes met camel trains from the desert.
So here we are. This is Kabara port, which is the closest point of the river Niger to Timbuktu.
This large town stands about 12 miles from Timbuktu upon the river Niger. And here are merchants that travel to the kingdoms of Guinea and Mali.
Leo made two trips to the Sudan and Timbuktu, one in early 1510 and one in 1513. On the first trip, he was an apprentice, a companion to his uncle, sent as an ambassador to Bilada Sudan, literally the land of the blacks. The purpose of his second trip was more mysterious. It could have been another diplomatic mission or even a spying mission covered by trade. One of the most lucrative commodities was salt blocks.
Salt would come from the north by caravans. It would take them about 2 to 3 weeks to reach Timbuktu. They sell this in return for gold.
Salt is in very short supply because it is carried here from Tighaza, 500 miles from Timbuktu. I happened to be in the city at a time when a load of salt sold for 80 ducats.
Here, a pound of salt could be exchanged for a pound of gold. Timbuktu was a city of unparalleled riches. It was claimed that by the 14th century, two-thirds of the world's gold passed through Timbuktu. Long known to the Arab world, it had been closed to non-Muslims for hundreds of years.
Leo Africanus was the man who brought the European obsession with Timbuktu, because it was his portrayal of the city as a place of incalculable wealth that got Europe all fired up. The British, the French, the Germans, the Italians, all the civilized European powers were set on one thing: to get a white man, a Christian, to Timbuktu and back.
But it would be nearly 300 years before a European made it to Timbuktu and lived to tell the tale.
When the Europeans got to Timbuktu and told their governments, well, actually, the Timbuktu is a hellhole, there's nothing here. It went down like a lead balloon. It went down very, very badly indeed, because the Europeans had wanted to be told, yeah, it's fabulous and we're all going to get rich.
The first to reach Timbuktu and return alive was a Frenchman called René Caillet. He was unimpressed and described the city as a mass of ill-looking houses built of earth.
When European explorers finally managed to reach Timbuktu, they were disappointed not to find the huge amounts of gold Leo talked about. But what they missed is the real treasures of the city, the thousands of priceless manuscripts hidden in its libraries.
There are in Timbuktu numerous judges, teachers, and priests, all properly appointed by the king. He greatly honors learning. Many handwritten books imported from Barbary are also sold. There is more profit made from this commerce than from all other merchandise.
Around the 14th and the 15th century, the most rewarding job in Timbuktu was calligraphy. Because Timbuktu was a place of knowledge and wisdom, so there were many, many calligraphers who wrote everything that the wise men said. In the 15th century, there were at least 500 calligraphers in Timbuktu, just to reproduce the manuscripts.
Here, Spain and Andalusia was to cross Leo's and my path once again. Like me and like Leo, Ismail Haidara's ancestor came from Spain, and he too wrote books about travel and the wider world.
En fait, ah oui, il y a des manuscrits. Ici, vous avez 52.
Here we have 52 manuscripts. They are written on goatskin because it's very resistant.
Do they last long?
Yes, indeed. Especially because of what the goats eat, which makes their skin quite strong.
Assez solide, okay. Qui tue plus. Oui, parce que quand on parle de Timbuktu, depuis le 14e siècle avec le pèlerinage de Campos.
When we talk about Timbuktu from the 14th century, we talk about the land of gold.
C'est le bilan de l'or, c'est aussi la terre de l'or. Or, Timbuktu.
But the real gold of Timbuktu is in the head and the manuscripts. It is actually science and culture, the wisdom of people. But you know, there was another kind of gold as well, and it's not material. Timbuktu was a meeting point, a crossing point, where traders coming from the south met those coming from the north. So Timbuktu was a melting pot, and this is the real wealth of Timbuktu.
Timbuktu was Leo's first glimpse of the wider world. He was a very young man when he first came here. To Europeans, Timbuktu conjures an image of the most remote place of the planet. But in Leo's time, it was one of the great meeting places in history. In later years, Leo's writings changed Timbuktu. But first, Timbuktu would change Leo.
Leo loved Timbuktu and described it well. He loved this city, and this is clear in his book, which in turn made Italians and others who read his book love it as well. There is a Sudanese proverb that says, salt comes from the north, gold from the south, and silver from the land of the white people. But the words of God and knowledge, and the good stories, we only find them in Timbuktu.
The description of Africa would have never made it to Europe if it were not for one monumental event in the life of Leo that propelled him into the heart of the Renaissance and made him one of the world's foremost writers.
In the early 16th century, the Mediterranean was a cauldron of rival fates and competing empires. The Ottoman Empire, the Turks, had recently taken control of Egypt. In Europe, Pope Leo X was trying to unite European monarchs into a new crusade against the enemy from the east.
Taking the war onto the high seas were competing fleets of Christian and Muslim pirates. It was Leo's apparent misfortune to fall into the hands of a Christian privateer in the summer of 1518.
Leo had been sent by the Sultan of Fes as an emissary to Constantinople, the capital of the Ottoman Empire. He was returning across the Mediterranean to Africa when he was captured by a ship of the Order of St. John, under the command of a soldier monk named Captain Pietro Bodiviglia, who was looking for plunder and slaves to enrich his order.
The order of the Knights of St. John of Jerusalem, Rhodes, and Malta is in fact the oldest order of chivalry in Europe. A knight had to be 18 years of age. He had to be strong and well-built, be prepared to give up his life for the Catholic faith. He also had to be an aristocrat, a nobleman. And this brought a lot of wealth to the order. So not only were they noble, but they were educated and they were also very rich. Their main mission at that time was to police, if you like, the North African coast. So it would stretch from Morocco all the way to Cyprus and Rhodes. They took their orders from the Pope. They were answerable to the Pope because the Pope's interest was not just the protection of the Catholic faith, but the protection of Rome itself. It was not just a religious war, you see, it was also an economic war.
Was the Pope happy with their activities in the Mediterranean, namely piracy and privateering?
Oh yes, for as long as it enriched the order and it kept the Ottoman Turks out of Europe, then he blessed their wars. They had his blessing, definitely.
Leo was taken by ship towards Rome, perhaps stopping en route in Malta, then a strategic Christian island in the middle of the Mediterranean. He would have been just one of countless African and Muslim slaves captured by the knights.
We know that at any time during the year, there were some 2,000 slaves kept in the so-called bagno. Bagno means a slave prison. There were Muslims and Jews and even Orthodox Christians sometimes. They were kept inside altogether. And these were sold locally to the Grand Masters, to the Knights of St. John, to the nobility, and some of them were even sold abroad. Some of them were exported, so to speak. Certain slaves who were recognized to be important, then of course the knights treated him differently. The first thing that they would seek would be to keep him as ransom, political ransom, but also financial ransom, to their enemy. And eventually, if they were found to be of significance, if they were sent to the palaces of Europe, to a prince or to the Pope, who would have sought the wisdom or the usefulness of this person in one way or another.
Leo's fate was to be sent to Rome as a gift to the Pope, the final stage in his transition from Muslim Arabic scholar to Christian European writer was about to begin. He was imprisoned in the dungeons of Castel San Angelo, the tomb of Hadrian. His survival and his new identity would depend upon capturing the attention of Pope Leo X himself.
Would be the castellans who would let him know that there was this slave who happened to have books with him, who happened to be reading and studying and having maps that would have piqued Leo's curiosity. Leo Africanus would provide a possibility for Leo the Pope to get a look at this other culture that was threatening him, was threatening his existence. The Pope was trying to mount a crusade, and Leo Africanus could have helped him in terms of his geographical knowledge about where he was going and how he should plan his military expedition. So evidently, Leo Africanus had something to offer to Leo X, because otherwise he would have died in the dungeons.
But the real key to Leo's success, and perhaps the only reason we in the West have heard about him, is that he chose to submit to the ultimate act of assimilation. The scholarly Muslim became a Christian.
Here in 1520, al-Hasan ibn Muhammad al-Wazzan was baptized into the Christian faith by the hand of none other than Pope Leo X himself.
The Christian name he was given was Johannes Leo de Medicis, named after the Pope.
Clearly, Leo Africanus' conversion is going to facilitate his life in Rome. It's going to make his life easier. He would exist only because he was able to curry favor with Leo X. I mean, he would have been seen as a protected member of the court, and for that reason, would have been left alone.
Whatever the Pope's intention, Leo now sets about writing his great book, The Description of Africa. It was the distillation of more than a dozen years of travel.
And so, having gotten a fit opportunity, I decided to commit my travels and notes into this volume.
They say that the Pope was interested in the description of Africa because he was launching a crusade, and so he was interested in Africa for tactical reasons, but I don't think it's only that. There was a scholarly community very eager to learn about the Muslim world. So that he was a teacher of Arabic for many scholars in Rome while he was there. He translated into Arabic some Christian books, St. Paul's letters. And also he wrote vocabulary in different languages, Spanish, Latin, Italian, and
Hebrew.
Arabic.
And Hebrew as well,
a medical
dictionary, I think, yeah.
It's quite impossible to realize how incredibly explosive the information he had was. The Arab world at the time was making use of knowledge from all across the Islamic world. It was just raging in terms of knowledge, in terms of education, wisdom. This was cutting-edge information. I mean, they had printing techniques at a time when in Europe there was none of that. He was a guy who was in the right place at the right time with pivotal information.
During the 9 years he spent in Europe, Leo was caught between East and West, between Arabic learning and the European Renaissance. It was a delicate act to maintain.
Knowing what Muslims are like, I'm sure he stayed a Muslim in his heart. But he told everyone, yeah, I've converted. And later he made it known, no, I was never a Christian, or I've reconverted back to Islam.
He was such a wise person. He knew that the way of life is to continue living, surviving. He can change his jacket and work for one and another, which was also, I would say, quite usual at that period.
I think he used the Islamic solution for conversion, which is taqiyya, which means pretending to be a Christian like others. What Europeans said about his conversion to Christianity is based on the good relationship with the Pope. But why would he sign his books with Leo Africanus, formerly known as al-Hasan ibn Muhammad al-Wazzan? Why stick with this? I think he was sticking to Islam. Why does he always link himself to the country he came from originally? Whenever he mentions Muslims, he says, we, linking himself to us.
The author admits to some shame and confusion in disclosing the vices and failings of Africa, having been nourished and raised there, and known as a man of purity. But it is necessary for whoever wants to write to tell things as they are.
Europeans delighted in Leo's descriptions and the inside information his book gave them on Africa. But how is he remembered there?
Aujourd'hui, on peut dire que Léon l'Africain.
Today, Leo is not as well known as René Caillé, Heinrich Barth, or Gordon Lang, or other explorers. He is only known amongst researchers. Do they think he's a traitor? No, the opposite. All intellectuals who know about Leo the African think proudly of him, especially the Andalusian community here. They consider him as one of them.
In 1527, after nearly 9 years in Italy, Leo abruptly leaves Christianity behind and simply vanishes. The only clue to his plans, a fragment from his notes.
After returning to my own country, I plan, with God's assistance, to describe the regions of Europe.
And with that, he disappears from history.
All we know for sure is that he left Italy right before the sack of Rome, heading to Tunisia, never to be seen again.
These are the things memorable and worthy of knowledge, seen and observed by me throughout all Africa, written at Rome in the year of Christ 1526. Here ends the description of Africa, written by John Leo, born in Granada and raised in Africa.
It from us this evening. Coming up tomorrow here on BBC HD, it's the opening day of Wimbledon 2011, and we've coverage from midday. Then at 9, Evan Davis presents a brand new series, Made in Britain, and at 11, the final episode of our drama, Case Histories. Bye-bye for now.
These Toubou women must venture across the vast sand seas of the Sahara in search of a miniature well just 1 meter square. It will mean the difference between life and death. Foni is a Toubou woman who can find her way to water without a map or a compass. She's brought her daughter, Shede, only 10 years old. The well they seek is still 3 days' walk away. This is the toughest journey they'll ever face together.